This morning, as we pick back up into the story, and I'm going to do a little recap in a minute, we're picking up about midway. If you have been reading the story along with us, you would be on chapter 15. We're about halfway through. That's amazing, right? And still in the Old Testament, because the Old Testament makes up about two-thirds of our Bible, and the New Testament is just about one-third. So we're halfway through our scriptures, going through that, but still deeply into the Old Testament. And now we find ourselves in that place where history, our history books that we have in the Bible, also coincide with some of the prophets. But as you look in the order of the Bible, they don't follow sort of that chronological order. We get the history first, and then we get prophets later, and sometimes it's hard to tell who goes with who. So this morning, and in the next couple of weeks, we're going to try to sort out where those prophets go and what message they continue to try to tell Israel and Judah. So this morning, we open with 1 Kings chapter 17, and this tells some of the story of the prophet Elijah. So let's hear the word of God together. I'll pick up at verse 7. And right before that, Elijah has told the king that there is going to be several years of drought. Woo, we've heard that message, yes? So there's going to be several years of drought, and it's only going to rain when Elijah says that it's going to rain. So clearly, we need Elijah. Perhaps his nickname is El Nino. So this is where we pick up. Sometime later, the brook dried up. Now, Elijah had been sent to a brook by God during this drought, and the ravens had been feeding him. So sometime later, the brook dried up because there had been no rain in the land. Then the word of the Lord came to him, "Go at once to Sephathera of Sidon, and stay there. I have commanded a widow in that place to supply you with food." So he went to Zephareth. When he came to the town gate, a widow was there gathering sticks. He called to her and asked, "Would you bring me a little water in a jar so I may drink?" As she was going to get it, he called, "And please bring me a piece of bread." "As surely as the Lord your God lives," she replied, "I don't have any bread, only a handful of flour in a jar and a little oil in a jug. I am gathering a few sticks to take home and make a meal for myself and my son, that we may eat it and then die." Elijah said to her, "Don't be afraid. Go home and do as you have said, but first make a small cake of bread for me from what you have and bring it to me. Then make something for yourself and your son. For this is what the Lord, the God of Israel, says, 'The jar of flour will not be used up and the jug of oil will not run dry until the day the Lord gives rain on the land.'" So she went away and did as Elijah had told her. So there was food every day for Elijah and for the woman and her family. For the jar of flour was not used up and the jug of oil did not run dry, in keeping with the word of the Lord spoken by Elijah. Some time later, the son of the woman who owned the house became ill. He grew worse and worse and finally stopped breathing. She said to Elijah, "What do you have against me, man of God? Did you come to remind me of my sin and kill my son?" "Give me your son," Elijah replied. He took him from her arms, carried him to the upper room where he was staying, and laid him out on his bed. Then he cried out to the Lord, "O Lord my God, have you brought this tragedy also upon this widow I am staying with by causing her son to die?" Then he stretched himself out on the boy three times and cried to the Lord, O Lord my God, let this boy's life return to him. The Lord heard Elijah's cry, and the boy's life returned to him, and he lived. Elijah picked up the child and carried him down from the room into the house. He gave him to his mother and said, Look, your son is alive. Then the woman said to Elijah, Now I know that you are a man of God, and that the word of the Lord from your mouth is the truth. This is the word of the Lord. Will you pray with me? Our Lord, our God, help us in this time to hear your word, to understand your prophecy for us this day through the prophets of old, through your people, Israel, and through your Son, Jesus Christ, the Savior who has been born to us. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. So here we are in chapter 15, and for those of you who may not have been reading the story along with us or new to our church, or some of you who have been reading and went, wait, that was way back in 15 chapters ago, here is the brief recap of where we're at. So God, being God, decided that he wanted to create because he is a creative God, and he makes our earth. And he forms it and he shapes it and he takes time to create something beautiful and magnificent. And part of that creation, he wants to share that creation. So he creates people, Adam and Eve, men and women. And he creates them in God's image. And he wants to share all of this with Adam and Eve, with the men and the women that he's created. And he wants to give them dominion over the earth. But he also gives them free will. He gives them choice. And he lays out before them everything. He holds nothing back. But in time, they are tricked. And they decide that it would be best to be gods themselves. And they fall to sin. And their eyes are opened and they understand good and evil. And then they have to live out their days working and toiling and turning back to God, which they don't do successfully. And as generations go on, God gets to a place where he's like, oh, I've had it. I want to wipe them all out. He wants a giant do-over. But instead, he decides to gather up Noah's clan. And he has the rain come, a massive El Nino. And it comes and it wipes out the earth, except for Noah and his clan and the animals that have been gathered together. And from that clan, God makes his first covenant. He promises never to destroy the earth completely. He promises Noah through the rainbow that he won't do that. And from Noah's clan comes Abraham. Faithful Abraham, who's called by God and told to be a father of a great nation, a childless couple in their old age, being called to be the father of a great nation. But Abraham follows God faithfully and does what God commands. And through him and his wife Sarah, in their very old age, have a son, Isaac. And Isaac grows up, and he gets a wife, Rebecca. And Rebecca gives birth to twins, Esau and Jacob. Twins that have sibling rivalry. And from that sibling rivalry, Jacob ends up having to flee because he's sure that his brother, after all his antics, is surely going to kill him. But in that time away, in that fleeing, that journey, he meets God face to face. And he goes and he marries two women who also have two extra women. And from that, he is the father of 12 sons. 12 sons. And now it is time to return home. And again on that journey home, he meets God again. He wrestles with God. He is changed and transformed. He is called now Israel. And he goes and he meets his brother, assuming that he will die, and instead is embraced by his family again. And from his 12 sons come the 12 tribes of Israel. And in God's usual fashion, God uses one of the younger sons to humble the older sons. And Joseph, the second to youngest, who is a pain in the rear to his older siblings, is finally sold into slavery by his siblings. Now, I know some of you older ones have always fantasized about doing that to the younger ones. Sells him. It doesn't work out so great sometimes, though, because the younger ones are wily. Joseph ends up rising to a position of prominence out of all the despair that he goes through, and ends up saving his entire family, inviting them to come to Egypt, to be with him there, to ride out the famine. And they do, and they are prosperous, and they grow, and they grow, and generations and generations and generations, and all of a sudden, there's a Pharaoh who doesn't know who Joseph was, doesn't remember how those Hebrews got there, and is fearful that they may one day become too powerful and enslaves them. So now the generations are calling out to God for redemption, calling out to God for freedom, calling out to God to be saved. And God sends a prophet, Moses. Moses, a tiny baby who is rescued from the Nile by Pharaoh's sister, who was raised in the courts of Pharaoh, who is a prince to Egypt, but apparently may have been infected by affluenza. Because he goes on a murderous rage and then has to flee the country. Mexico? No. He flees. And as he is in the Sinai Peninsula, is confronted by God in a burning bush, is called to his senses, is called to his role of prophet, is confronted by God and told what he must do. And eventually, Moses obeys. And he goes back to Egypt, and after 10 plagues and a Passover, he rescues his people. They cross the Red Sea back into that Sinai Peninsula, and in that very same place, Moses is given the 10 commandments, the crowning pinnacle of what has happened so far. But while he is there communing with God, the people already stumble and fall. They decide that they don't know what to do without their leader, and they need to make a little god to worship. So they put together a golden calf and already stray. When Moses comes down the mountain, he is furious, and he smashes the 10 commandments. Now he's got to go and do it again. It's like having to write, I will not smash the tablets. I will not smash the tablets on the chalkboard. So he goes, receives them again, and also gets instructions for the Ark of the Covenant, for the tabernacle, which is their mobile worship station as they wander through the desert, the place where they come and they worship God, and it can be moved from area to area. The Ark of the Covenant resides in there, and the people wander for 40 years. Didn't stop to ask for directions, couldn't figure it out, and after two generations are finally allowed into the promised land, and Joshua becomes their commander and leads them into conquest into that promised land. And as we're reading through the stories, you remember these are bloody, awful battles. And it was hard to read some of this. How is this God's plan? But we had to keep reminding ourselves of what the upper story was telling us. That we experience it differently in our lower story, but what God is trying to do constantly, calling his people back, calling his people back. So he leads them into the promised land, and in that land, they want a king, but he says, no, let's have judges. So they go through a period, and they have Deborah, and they have Gideon, and they have Samson, all people with flaws, but great leadership, and continuing trying to keep those people on that straight and narrow with God. And after some time, God acquiesces to the people because they want a king, because they want to be just like everyone else. And so they get a king, they get Saul. The prophet Samuel anoints Saul, and Saul's good for a while, but then is overtaken by his own evil spirits. And so Samuel has to anoint David as the next king in his youth. David goes out and he slays Goliath. The people are starting to get behind him as king, but he has to wait for Saul to pass away, and he will not take Saul's life. And finally, David, a man described as someone after God's own heart, ascends the throne, King David, son of Jesse. From his shoot comes our Messiah. And David was a good king, faithful to God, tenacious about God, but flawed, and commits an egregious error with Bathsheba that leads to even more terrible decisions on his part. But the thing about David is when he is confronted with his sin by the prophet Nathan, he repents. He turns away from the evil he was doing and turns towards God again. He repents, he receives forgiveness, and he is changed and transformed and leads Israel in faithfulness to God. And then his son Solomon comes online, someone who is very wise and has a lot of wives. And there was his fall. Solomon, who built the temple for God, Solomon, who penned the Proverbs, also the man that began leading Israel in the wrong direction because of the influence of so many wives. That's why there's only one for each now. If you learn from that. So Solomon leads Israel down a dark path. He starts them on that journey, and from his kingdom, the kingdom of Israel is divided in two. There are the northern kingdom of Israel, which comprised of 10 of the tribes, and then the southern kingdom of Judah, which had 2 of the tribes. And that is where chapter 15 picks up. We have a divided kingdom, and we wonder why it is, how that happens. How did this kingdom of God become divided? Because as we follow the story from Abraham on down, we see Israel not obeying God. We see Israel not being fully devoted to God as they become complacent and disobedient and rebellious. They are no longer showing God's plan to the other nations around them. If God were to continue to bless them, even though they had turned away from God, this would have sent the wrong message both to Israel and to the surrounding nations. So at the end of the day, God allows the tribes to separate so that he could accomplish his upper story plan of bringing a Messiah through the line of Abraham and through Jesse and David through the tribe of Judah. Israel, in that northern kingdom, was very rebellious. And if you look at the lineage of their kings, not one of them did good. Now, Judah, which we will probably talk about next week, had a few kings. Every other or so was a king that would bring that nation back to God. But in Israel, it was not so. It started with King Ahab and his evil queen Jezebel, who you may want to think of as the Old Testament version of Cruella de Vil. She was horrible and influenced Ahab and took that nation of Israel, that northern kingdom, down a very dark path. But God was always chasing them, always giving them an opportunity to change, even that northern kingdom. In fact, he gives them 208 years to change. He sends them prophets, nine of them, over the course of 19 kings to try to convince them to change their ways, to turn back towards God. And these prophets that came, like Elijah, they spoke very loudly to Israel. God wanted to make sure that his message was heard. They had messages that played out over time in the kingdom of Israel. Elijah was sent specifically to confront King Ahab and his evil queen. He came and he told him, you're going to have drought for years until I say that it rains. And this was a direct affront to the god Baal that they were worshiping, because Baal was the god of fertility, the god of rain. But the God of Israel, Yahweh, says through Elijah, there will be no rain. And then Elijah is sent away to prepare for the message that he is to give. He's sent away and fed by ravens, and then taken care of by the widow, whose son he resurrects in this grand miracle. But that was not the granddaddy of them all. Elijah steps up to the stage, and he calls the people together and he says, all of you that are following Baal, I want you to get all your priests together. And you're going to build an altar and we're going to have a sacrifice. We're going to have a sacrifice off. We're going to have two altars and you're going to build yours and I'm going to build mine. And then we're going to really see who God is. This is like the ninja warrior thing of the Old Testament. So the Baal worshipers, they get over there and they build their thing and they get their bull and they slice it up and they dance around and dance around. And Elijah is over there mocking them. teasing them, taunting them. Hey, where's your God? He's not here. And they start cutting themselves. They're going crazy. It's a frenzy over here. Nothing. And the day had grown long, and Elijah comes over here and uses 12 stones to symbolize those 12 tribes of Israel, and he builds the altar, and he puts the bull on there, and he builds up all this wood for the fire, but then he tells the priests, pour water on it. Pour water all over this, so much that it filled the trough that was around it. And then Elijah called for God. And there was so much fire that it consumed everything, including the water. This was a huge spectacle. Even Disney couldn't come up with this. And yet, the people could only turn back towards God for a little while. Only for a little while. And Elijah is feeling like he's alone and isolated, and he's having his own little pity party. Oh, I'm the only one that's faithful. Oh, God, why me? Just let me die. And God comes to him and reminds him that he is not alone. Reminds him that there are people scattered throughout the nation who are faithful and who are doing God's work in small ways that added up to big things. And so he gives Elijah a helper. Elisha becomes his counterpart. And God continues to send prophets to Israel, not only Elisha, but he sends Hosea, he sends Amos, he sends Jonah to call Israel back into relationship. Hosea's, his prophecy, his relationship, his marriage to a prostitute was a parable for God's relationship with Israel. Hosea being faithful, faithful, faithful to his wife. God and Israel have a covenant relationship, but Israel, like Hosea's wife, is unfaithful. And for years, God calls back, please come back. And finally, God says through Hosea, I still love you. Come home. We are still vulnerable to that same type of sin that was in Israel. We are vulnerable to turning our back to God. We want to worship the gods, the little gods, of our own choosing sometimes. And if we're not careful and we don't pay attention, we can find ourselves chasing things that have no eternal value. We begin making adjustments for those things that bring us pleasure, but temporary pleasure in our lives. And so the one true God is set aside for our little gods. If you look at the prophets, it's sad to say that in Israel, there was only one prophet, Jonah, who people actually listened to. Jonah is the one, if you remember way back to Sunday school, did not want to send God's message and was swallowed up by a giant fish and then barfed back up onto the seashore, all slimy and gooey and ready to follow God. And Jonah doesn't want to take the message that he has because he's taking it to pagans. He's taking it to non-believers to begin with in Nineveh. But he goes and he takes the message and they listen. They actually, the pagans, not the Israelites, the pagans are the ones that turn around and follow God. Oh, and Jonah is so angry about this that he goes up and he like other prophets, I just want to die. And God again reminds him that it is a blessing to have those following God, that he was true in his message and that people were given the chance for life. A message that Amos and Hosea could not get through to the people of Israel, Jonah was able to get through to the pagans who immediately followed God. When we read these stories of the prophets, we will learn that these prophets were vulnerable, that they had the same insecurities that we feel. Some felt isolated and alone. Some of them grew angry and bitter because the people would not listen. And they sometimes rebelled against God and protested and even ran away for a period. But in time, these prophets grow to understand God, to understand their calling, to understand their place in this kingdom. They understand their mission and their ministry, and they offer themselves to the people in hopes that the people will return back to God. God is still speaking today. There are prophets among us, and we have to choose whether we will listen to the message or will we ignore it like the Israelites did. God speaks to us through God's word. God speaks to us through the people that we worship with. God speaks to us in our dreams and our desires and our passions that God gives us. God speaks to us through the Holy Spirit to convict us and to comfort us and to show us how we are to respond to God's call. So what is God calling you to today? As we start 2016, as we linger in Christmas and acknowledge our Savior born into our lives, what is it that God is calling you to in 2016? What star is leading you to Bethlehem? What gifts do you have to bring the Savior? Is God giving you a word to share with someone else? Is God calling you to go somewhere or return home, to start to do something, to join something? It is the beginning of a brand new year, an opportunity for us to hear the words of the prophets and return back to God. Amen.